Thank you. Thank you guys for helping in the setup. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to my talk. In this talk, my main aim is to tell you guys how Graylog helped me and how I tried the various other solutions and Graylog stood out among others. So this is how I came to know that Graylog can be helpful to me, especially in logging my application data, my application logs, and how I can visualize it on the dashboard of Graylog. I mainly use Graylog for my Django logs. I am a Django developer. I have 3 instances of Django running, and I need their logs to be streamlined. And I use it for my Nginx logs to check the status of the return status code that we are going. So we are going to have a quick look on the dashboard as well in the real time. So let's start. We are running out of time. So I have noticed that Graylog is very good when you want to have a system for log management and analysis, regardless of what kind of data you're collecting, whether it's an event log or your stack log, what technology, what configuration you're putting it. Graylog integrates very smoothly. It doesn't need any extra effort, very extreme effort in setup, and it helps a new learner to get most out of its data. So this is about me. I'm in Python from last 10 years, and I'm freelancing from last 3 years. And I am working as a technical lead or senior Python developer, whichever profile you would like to name it. I prefer digital nomad. Rest is story. So whenever when we are dealing with log management, our major concern is always how we should put the data in a specific structure and how we should have our logs, specifically in my case, in such a way that it can be helpful to me. But when I was experimenting with Graylog, I figured that there are other things which we can also do with logs. My only concern at that time was when production was going down or any user was having any issue, I just go into the file. At that time, I was using file handler of Python. I just go into the file, I go through the logs and see where the things went wrong. But through Graylog, I thought that I can do more with my data. So in general sense, we have learned this, that a centralized logging technology or centralized strategy is very helpful in any stack, because your stack doesn't comprise only of a single node or a single instance. In my case, stack have Nginx, it has GUnicorn, it has our Graylog, it has Django servers, it has Celery. There are many things that your stack have. And when you want to actually see where the logs are, where actually the issue happened, if you are having a file handler, you just have to go in the file and search where you have to streamline all the different kind of logging files. It becomes cumbersome when your stack grows. So the choice of scalable log management solution should be very, very thoroughly thought, because it really helps you in longer term, especially when you look 2 years in the future. You need to understand that whatever you will set up at the early stage should be for the longer run. So my priority, apart from figuring out the errors, my priority also included what more I can do with the data that I'm collecting, or what tool should I use to visualize this data to help me understanding the bottlenecks of my system? So these are the basic Python logging handlers that you know. I was using either file or email, syslogs. So these are the basic file handlers that we use in general day-to-day production. But this leads to the problems like, sorry. So if you don't have a centralized log management, believe me, you will have unstructured logs. It will be scattered across different clusters. You will not be able to visualize which cluster actually created the problem. You will not be able to monitor your logs. You cannot do a real-time analysis over a graph or a globe. And when I tried with the existing other options, like if you have heard of Loglly, it's one of the tools which provide the cloud solution. But my issue with Loglly was that it was cloud solution. I cannot rely on that for my client's data, so I cannot use that. So the slide which you have already seen, all these problems leads to this. Lots of weekends with only errors. That's what we reached to. It's a I'll tell you the story in short. We reached to Graylog. The story started when we started having a problem with salary, but we didn't know. And salary was the last thing in the stack we expected to have the memory leak, but it was having a memory leak. And we were not able to figure that out. It took us 3 weeks to figure out the memory leak in that. But when that happened, I realized that I really need something in place, even at the initial stage of deployment, that will tell me where actually the problem is happening. So that's a different story. The talk on salary is I gave in PyCon Malaysia. It was an interesting adventure of three weeks, and the change was of one line in the code base of salary, that too. So it's a havoc when you have to work 21 days in stretch and you don't know where you are banging your head. So the solution which fits my requirement was Graylog. Why it fit? Because it gives me, first of all, user authentication, which I was not finding in other on-premise installation at that time. Later I figured out it is now available with Elk. At that time it was not there. Then it gives me different kinds of data format that I can pass. And it was quite fast. The analysis speed, the data it was generating on, as soon as the data come, it will come up with the on the dashboard. It was quite fast for me. The cost was comparatively less because it supports 5 GB of logs per month. It's free for up to 5 GB of logs per month. So that was sufficient for me. I think it is going to be sufficient for another 2 years also if I start purging my data, if I don't need historical data. And error stack traces were really helpful. I think the credit should go to Python logging as well in this case, because it is very good in giving the tracebacks. And search syntax was really helpful. It is the usual SQL queries which we run. So it's not a very big thing to put your mind into, oh, how can I now scan or search all the logs? Again, the query and parsing language was quite flexible and helpful, and it has the similar syntax that we have seen before. So this is the basic, I should say, stack of Graylog. You have the service which is sending the logs. If you want, you can put a load balancer. If your logs are very big, you can have a cluster of Graylog. So the load balancer will stay there. Then you have Graylog server. It uses MongoDB for obvious reasons, the writes are very high. And it uses Elasticsearch for indexing. And then it has its own interface. Now, the web interface is really helpful for me in checking the day-to-day health of my production server. So it basically looks something like this. You can see how many 200, 403, 404 have you responded, how many API calls I have got. In short, this is basically monitoring the API calls. These are the exposed API calls for outer world. These are REST API calls. And which client has done more calls, which client is more active throughout the day. All those things can be seen in histogram or pie chart or just counts or table or globe, whichever you want. In this, Zunison is the company who lent me their Graylog server to get this data. Now, why I chose Graylog? Because Graylog was the purpose of building the Graylog as per their coder or as per their developers is to, you know, have a system which is efficient and which deliver the context and scale to log analysis. So their main concern was logs. They were focused on logs. They only cared about the logs. Your logs should be your tools, not your hurdles. That was their concern. So that was the only thing they had in mind. The analysis of logs should be fast. It should be easy to use for even a non-developer. It should have a simple infrastructure to be deployed. It should have the lower cost than the alternatives, all those things. And it should be able to scale to customer service. There should not be any too much expert training needed for the setups. To me, DevOps was a new area because I've worked as a developer majorly. I think almost 9 years continuously as a developer, past 1 year as a DevOps. But still, I was able to set up this without any much issues. Obviously, we have to check the documentations, we have to check the community. But my setup was basic, a single instance, and this stand out in the settings. The setup was pretty easy for me. Now, we can ask that who can use the Graylogs, because there are so many options in the industry of logging or the centralized logging. Who will use the Graylog? Why will somebody use the centralized logging solution, in short, when you can have, you know, some people loves to have scattered data. So this is my concern, that regardless of what data or what stack you use, the tool which you use to handle your data should be the right tool. It doesn't have to be a fancy tool, but it should be the right tool because your tool determines where you are going with your log analysis. So I can say that if you have a correct data, in my case it was logs, but you can have any kind of data. So it can use the analysts as well, so that they don't have to be very much fluent in Graylog. The dashboard of Graylog is pretty easy to navigate. You can create your own input streams that will serve as an endpoint, and the sender will just use the port and IP or the host name and the send the data. And analyst, if they are okay with putting the extractor of that data, that's fine. Else, Graylog Marketplace is very good. You can find somebody who has already written the extractor for you. So the interface for analyst is very good. Then there are compliance specialists. So this is as per the Graylog community, and I quote, that bring data in from any application at any time. Graylog is fault tolerant by design, preventing data loss even during load spikes and require no additional component for distributed load balanced operation. This is something which I haven't tried, so I said I quote what they have said. Of course, it is useful in case of checking the security of your system. You can put your syslogs or the event logs in Graylog and check if there is any attack or any threat in your system. So security experts can use it for that thing. Same could be the reason for IT teams to use it to monitor the data center or the cloud solution or the hybrid environment which they're monitoring. Everything can be streamlined and properly strategically aligned in a single workspace, a single dashboard. It can be helpful for enterprise executives because the cost is lower and it includes collection of all the data, and it helps in standardizing log platforms for handling multiple use cases like application logs, DevOps logs, system monitoring logs, your user monitoring logs, your user side logs if you're running any user agents. So the cost is very less compared to others. In short, it can be used by anyone who wants to have a seamless, which wants to seamlessly control its data, transfer it, store it, analyze it. The log streams are of different kinds in Graylog that we can use. Obviously, you have to choose which one suits you the best. Now, there are other solutions as well, and I have used them. I would say that I will start with the stack which I used was Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. At that time, if you needed authentication in Kibana, that means only you should be able to see your logs. Nobody else should be able to see it. You have to buy a pack called XPack, else it was free. And Logstash was consuming too much CPU for me. Okay. And it was very resource consuming and it was causing me problem at the AWS because we needed something which some stack which we can run on our 10 GB instance of a small instance of AWS. So Elk was not helping, but it seems that XPack is now removed from Elk and they are providing the authentication for free. I haven't tried it. This is something which I came to know today. Then I tried Splunk. It's commercial. I just used the free instance of them, but I wasn't very happy. I use Sentry, but they are logging only the 400 errors, 500 errors. They're not giving me how many. They were not giving me the ratio of how many good thing happens. They were only telling me what the bad thing happens. Sometimes good thing happens and still user is not happy with the data. How will you figure that out? In my case, user is saying that I'm not able to see certain data. From my side, everything is working fine. That will not get logged in Sentry. And the cloud solutions like Loggly and others, obviously the data leak was a risk. Given that every day we are looking at newspaper or the news headlines, somebody someplace is leaking the data or the credentials of user or the profile data of the user. So my client was a startup and they wanted to be sure that the data is not going in under the hand. So cloud solution was a big no. Now, there was a situation for us where our logs were unstructured. And I was worried that I have to change my log lines because that's what I had to do with Sentry That's what I had to do with Logstash and some point at Logly. So that was my concern, that I have to again change my log lines as per the structure that will be easily parsed by Graylog. But for my surprise, the Graylog was ready for this kind of instance or this kind of problem at the user end, and they provided something called Graylog extractors. So this is the official definition of Graylog extractor. So you just throw at the Graylog extractor, and if you want, you can put your own regular expression, and they will extract the data as per your regular expression. Now, in general, if you put any data or any log line, you unknowingly have some structure to it, which is known only to you, which is relevant only to you. Maybe it is not relevant to Logly or Splunk. So Graylog extractor can help you in that case. You can write a regular expression to extract only user email and tokens of your users, and store or and use it for indexing or use it for filtering out the data. Same with the grok pattern, it can be used to extract the data. And what I'm using is the JSON extractor for my Nginx logs. Now let's see at the what changes I had to do for my Nginx logs. This is the standard log line of Nginx. It comes with the configuration file of Nginx, right? In this, it will just tell you the timestamp, the API call, the user agent used, response, return, all those things. Now, to use it with more detail so that I will know other things as well in my logs, I had to add this data in my Nginx configuration file and send it as a system log to my Graylog server. And at the Graylog side, there was another guy called Paul. He has written an extractor for Nginx. I just imported that extractor, and everything started working fine. Let me show you the dashboard of that. Wait. Second. Okay. Okay. Is it coming? Yeah. Okay. So, sorry, I'm not able to see now. So when it's a JSON file which that person has written, which is an extractor. I just imported that JSON file. It automatically created two streams of UDP. This is the input stream. It is a receiver end. And my Nginx will send syslogs, the structured syslogs, to this in the format that we are capturing. And okay, let it get the data. In the meantime, we will see this. So this is the data that I am receiving and I'm visualizing. This is the histogram of last 1 week or whatever data I want. I have the API counts with the values of which is getting used more. I can see on the globe where is the API calls are getting most called. If I click on it, it will tell me the coordinates and it will tell me how many API calls that particular device has done. This is again the pie chart, and I can just give the counts also. I'm new to this laptop. Yeah, so this is the logs that we are receiving. I'll just click on one of it. You can see the fields that I have put in the new log format. All these are coming here, so that means these can be used as a filter option. You can use the message as a filter, you can use the method as a filter. So here, all these things, request method, whether it's a post or get, how many posts you have responded, how many posts with the 400 you have responded, all things, these things you can visualize, because now you can use these fields to filter your data, and you can put that on your dashboard. These things come pretty handy when you are dealing with huge data, at least 1 GB per week. How I'm using it in my setup of Django? So I'm using a library called GrayPy. Okay, and I'll show you if it, let's go back here. We will see the, in the meantime, it's loading. We will see how we are using it here. So if you have used the logging module of Python, you will know that you can use your own formatter. In that you can, they have the predefined fields which you can, which it automatically extract from the log line, which in my case I'm using the formatter, which is the timestamp, the path of file which is in which that log line exists, the line number from where that log line is being logged. Email is my custom field, it is not in the logging module. Message is the standard message which we put. Now, how I'm putting in my log line, if it's an error, so log.error and error message will come, will get logged in the message keyword, and there is an extra dict, there is an extra dictionary which contains email, which is the custom field of mine. I want to store it and use it for my data filter, for my log filter, and I will just pass the user email in that. Okay, now what I just have to do in this case, I have to create an input stream. Obviously, there should be a receiver at the Graylog side. So I just created an input stream of TCP in this case. It is the basic setup. It is going to use the default IP. I'll define the port number. That's it. Because it's on the AWS instance, I can enable the TLS, but not right now. It supports the TLS as well. So I've created the input stream. And I'll use here, in Python logging module, you have to mention the formatter, the handler, and the user. So in the handler, I will use the GELF TCP handler, which is by default will call the TCP handler in the GrayPy library. You just have to import that library and use the TCP handler. And it will start sending the data to our new stream of Django logs that we have created. It seems that it's, is it, okay, apart from the talk, does it seems a bit of confusing.
But why KCP? Why not UDP? Won't that it means that you're actually having a blockchain connection and everything happening?
One second, sorry.
Why is TCP used instead of UDP in this case?
You can use UDP, that's your choice. I'm going to put TLS in this, so because it's not only my server which is going to send the data, there are multiple servers, so I'm going to put TLS in this, so that's why it's easier. So when I was using the other solutions like Sentry, Logging, Elk, it was difficult, there was no option at that time for me to define my custom field. This is the big thing for me, because if I have a custom field, I can just filter the logs as I'm doing the filter in the files. I'm having a log file. If I want to search something, I am just cat, log file, pipeline, grep, the token. It will tell me all the details, all the logs related to that token. Then I'm further putting the grep. That's what I was doing at that time. Same thing I can do using token as a filter, that too in the dashboard. That was a big thing that was really helpful to me. So for me, when it's come to setup, all I had to do is install MongoDB. It's up to me. I was running it locally. No outside connection was allowed. So I put its credentials in Elasticsearch, install Elasticsearch and connect to MongoDB, install Graylog, connect to Elasticsearch and MongoDB. That was the basic setup I did, and it was pretty easy for me to just run it and use it. Whereas when I was using other solutions, it was a bit tricky for me, like in Sentry, the log lines which I have to put has to be structured as per their requirement. They were not handling or they were not supporting the custom fields like other solutions as well. So this was a bit of a breather for me, because I can put any custom field on which I want to put filter on. With this, my experience with Graylog so far is very good. I know Gray, maybe, I'm not sure about others, but from others I heard that Graylog was not that much known to people. But if you have a small setup and you're going to scale it, and you're sure that you are not going to have more than a certain amount of data, you're not going to have if you're not going to have more unstructured data, you are going to use your own custom fields to put the filters. Graylog is really good in that case. So I want to take this moment to thank Zunison, because they let me look into their Graylog server. They let me check their health status and everything. And what we saw is from their server only, their live monitoring. It also helps them in one more way, which we have not covered here. So Zunison is a smart home device company. That means it has router firmware running at their end. And they have put a user agent which will monitor the firmware and send the logs to backend. Now, over the time, those log lines has changed with different versions of hardware and different things that is getting added into that. So Graylog was really helpful for them, because the extractor they can write, the data they can analyze using that, because firmware logs were pretty tricky for them. But Graylog really helped them in that case. That is not under me, but I am helping them only with the extractor. But this really helps them. If you need this, these are the useful links. One of the GitHub link is mine. So Graylog 3 configuration, this is related to the Django server configuration, which you will be needing, which I have covered shortly here. The fourth number one is the Nginx extractor, which is already written. You can check the marketplace. There are many extractors which are already written. If you have a well-known application, chances are that the extractor is already written for it. So instead of writing your own extractor, you can check that. Thank you. This is the code which